Friday night, Waterfront Hall in Belfast, live podcast, 2,000 people, all the sippers. Let's go have tea with them.
Sippers, please welcome to the stage, Shane. Look at this. Here's what we're doing here. We're doing an episode of the podcast. Whenever I like introduce the episode, so don't make a noise until I do, and then everyone just go mental whenever I say the thing that I say at the start. Everyone got it? Calm down, mate. Sippers, welcome to the Tea With Me podcast with me, Shane Todd. Yes! Live at the Waterfront Hall, guys, thank you so much for coming out to this, doing the podcast for a couple of years. We didn't know if anybody would listen to it, never mind this. Waterfront Hall, Friday night, Belfast. This is unreal. Give yourselves a massive round of applause as well. Love that. We did the first live podcast in Limelight 2 a year ago, and there was 120 people, so this is absolutely nuts. We shouldn't be doing this here. This is too respectful of a venue. There's normally a wee blind singer. What do you call? He should be here. Do you know what I mean? I don't know who I mean. Who's a Pavarotti's dead, mate. I say dead. I am about to introduce him in a second, but I'm sorry, Dave. I mean Bocelli. That's it. Ladies and gentlemen, I've got a couple of guests here. We're just going to do the episode, the Tea With Me podcast. Yous are here. It's going to be a great night. You ready for me to welcome on my first guest? Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Papa Bear himself, the one, the only, Dave Elliott! Last time he was on this stage, he was singing Nessun Dorma. People were crying. Sit down, will you? Ladies and gentlemen, my next guest is the Goblin King himself. Please raise a roof for the Master of Coin, Kieran Bartlett! Looking like he's just about to start breakdancing at any point in that tracksuit. Ladies and gentlemen, Dave Elliott and Kieran Bartlett. Look at this. Isn't this nuts?
It's very casual, isn't it?
This is nuts.
It's mental, huh?
Thank you very much for coming on the podcast, guys. Appreciate it. Big friends of the pod, obviously. What are you doing?
Just making sure it's all.
You're like a villain there.
Now, the last time we did this, I was just saying, Limelight, about 100 people, and it was great. It was a good, you cracked up. Do you think you have an anger problem, really? And this is an intervention. Kieran, do you think you have an anger problem right now?
No. No.
The reason you got so annoyed last time was anybody at the first one we did?
Yeah.
So we were talking about you doing music back in the day. I mentioned you did. You claim to have invented live music in Belfast.
Yous are welcome.
You said the guy with the guitar in a smoking area, you started that.
I did start that. When I started that, there was nobody doing that.
There will be people doing tea with me, drinking bingo here, and doing shots of tea, and you telling me to fuck up after 4 seconds.
Sorry. I did start that.
Yeah.
I know I started it because when I was doing it, people used to throw money at me like I was begging.
Right.
So I know I was starting it, and there was no mics or
Where was it? 1885?
No, serious. It was you had to sit out the back of a nightclub and basically scream Red Hot Chili Peppers at people.
Right.
Like, it was mental. So
did
I know I started.
Did they know you were there, or were you just...
What?
Did they know you were there? Or were you
they
just...
didn't know I worked there, so they were like throwing money. And I used to think they think I'm begging, and then we'll put out a wee pint glass for it after a while. But no, seriously, it was like I started that.
And it was you and your mate. And the reason you cracked up on the first live podcast we did in the limelight was because you were talking about your mate who you performed with. You were, it was
Johnny.
Yeah. Which, when Kieran says Johnny in his voice, definitely sounds like he's saying Gianni. And me and Dave just thought, just Kieran, an Italian guy, we're on about McCrackens.
It was, yeah, I cracked up because, like, we were talking about it. You didn't believe me that I'd started it, but we fucking still did don't. Start it. And then, put it this way, in 2006, there was fucking nobody else doing that. And now everywhere has it 7 nights a week. Yous are welcome. Like, seriously. Thank you.
Is Gianni in?
He's sure he lives in fucking London now.
Okay. He's,
yeah. Via Naples.
Gianni blew up.
Yeah, he's. I think he just like has a wee pint glass beside him wherever he goes now in London. But I'm for catching.
Where
the
would points. You just play? Like, where was your big haunt?
McCracken's.
I've never been.
Up the hoods. It was in Joy's Entry. I happen to know that it was on the built on the side of an old prison house. I just know this shit. Yeah. And it's where the newsletter started. The newsletter used to sell. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Anyway,
you started the newsletter factory and you were like, I don't know if they're here for that.
I'm legitimately going back to 1737 to tell this story, right? When the newsletter started, it was under the sign of that bar. But anyway, we used to play in there. This guy, the DJ, hired us. And we just played in there every Saturday, and it used to get kind of quite like, it used to get quite rowdy and quite minging quickly. Like, we were playing mate, the amount of times.
There's another shot.
The amount of times, me and Johnny were sort of musical snobs, but like people would just shout for Wonderwall all night, and it used to drive me up a fucking
here,
wall.
That was definitely me and him.
And, so annoying. And do you know what it was? See, even if we were just walking in with a guitar, somebody would stop me and go, this Wonderwall. You're just saying, I haven't even fucking got in here yet. Do you know what I mean? Oh, mate, so melting.
Dave, did you go to McCracken's?
No. I don't think anyone went to McCracken's.
But you actually were a big nightclub guy.
Because I'm out about town, certainly, but I wasn't really, like, I wouldn't have been, I would have been in, like, cooler spots, like Beach Club, whatever. You know,
yeah, oh, yeah.
Cooler spots, yeah.
Sound the glory hole of Belfast, 06.
I just went, mate, you're like, nobody went to McCracken's. I'm like, the tens of people would disagree with you, Dave. It used to be jammed every week. It was mental.
That's because he heard there's some mental bastard out the back just playing a guitar for no reason.
No mic. Yeah. Micless. Yeah, no, it used to be actually nuts. Like, there was, do you know what was mental? In the middle of the bit out the back, like in the smoking area, like, because this is pre-smoking ban. All right, this is...
How old are you?
when the smoking ban came in, we were among the first to do up out the back, right? And I remember...
Johnny!
There was...
We'll call this a beer garden.
There was a wee shin-level wall. I don't know why I was there. There was a wee shin-level wall.
Kieran,
out the back.
Are you on spice? Johnny! There is too much interior music, Johnny. We will venture outside.
It was crazy. People used to come out and they'd get quite raucous and jump up and down and all. And like, people would go, ooh. And
Woodstock 99.
Women used to get their high heels stuck in the wee drains and all. And then Johnny would pray on them. But it was like,
So you're saying, like a cow getting stuck in a cattle grid?
Yeah,
Johnny would
get stuck in there, and Johnny just stop playing Wonderwall and be like, get her twank, you know what I mean? It was like, I'm only joking. it was mad. It was like
I've captured one, Johnny.
Loads of I captured fuck all except pot noodles on the way home. It was a nightmare. I used to be like, I was so bad. Johnny was the guy. Like, Johnny was like fucking Blurt Russell. Like, he loved it. Like, do you know what I mean?
What was a horror story? Like, did you ever, like, because you hate people coming up and touching you.
I hate people touching me. People, well,
see if you see Kieran in public, touch him.
Have I told you about this? The pose that I do and all the photos that I stop for people? It's a fucking please don't touch me pose. And it's also a both my hands are in this photo, you'll not cancel me today pose. Have you seen this? I do this.
It's then Gianni's in the background there, just fucking grabbing him.
He like, no, it was mad, and they're like, people would come up and ask for songs and all, and that was all mostly okay. But like, I mean, if you're asking for a shite like The Gambler, fuck off, right? But like, if you were asking for like a sting
B-side, I was gonna say, here, fuck off.
Do you know any early Damien Rice? I do. It used to be good. And then like, but like ladies and stuff would come up, and they would come over. They were very coy though, because they would come over and they'd touch my arm, and my wee brain's going, whoa, go on, twank, right? Can hear my dad just going, careful. Right, now go on, happy days.
Get her booked.
And then the question was always the same. Oh, he's really good tonight. Is Johnny about? And I'd be like, oh, fuck off. Another night with the pot noodle.
Gianni was sitting in Speranza's with a full carbonara. Mamma mia. Where was Gianni from right now?
Dunmurray. Oh, yeah, that's mad though. The wall though, the wall is a memory I always have, because...
The wall. It's a memory I always have, you bastard.
There was this wee... It was about 1 foot. It was literally at... It was
looks
just
bigger on the telly.
It was just high enough up your leg that if, like, you're going to fall over. Do you know what I mean? And people did every week. It was nuts.
Hold on. Let me. So you designed this back area.
No,
right?
I didn't design it. I just played there.
You put that is something traps. He would do.
Yeah, we trip up walls.
Yeah. There's traps. Yeah, there's there's food traps, the wall. And then we had the wee rat's dungeon down the back, which was where we would like leave our gear for a week, like our speakers.
And then the Specs of Belfast would break in and they'd steal it.
And it was properly ranking there where all the speakers were. There was actual rats in there. It was fucking stinking.
Right. Oh, wow.
Did a good steak, though.
Right. Hey, man, might have been rat.
Occasionally, do you know what it was, though? It was in those times when people you would get free drink at a gig.
It was times when...
Would you even have availed of that? It was like free drink at gigs and all. You used to get fucking...
Go to the right tavern.
I will have the mead.
Wait, did you say go to the right tavern?
Yes.
We used to play in White's Tavern as well. True story. It was mad. We played it. I fucking invented it. I won't hear different.
Do you know what? I can 100% see you going around and charging boys playing now commission.
Or Kevin does this full time now, and I'm literally
what,
just
collects like, your money from people. Yeah.
I just literally like I without me, Kev has no career. Yeah.
Right.
That's my sister's laughing at that.
Now let me ask you about like a venue like this, because you're playing like the Smoking Area, McCracken's. Where else you gonna play at City Centre Bars?
Yeah.
So
I mean, literally name one, and I've played in it. I swear to God.
The Rotary Club.
The what?
Fuck up.
Oh, super. Well played.
I like the idea though that you designed this wall, and you like, I love the idea that you got asked to do one gig and showed up with like artist representations of what you would like the venue to be.
What fucking bar, sorry, is going, that's a great idea, Kieran, we'll build that for you, no problem. Like,
I didn't design it, they just built
you did?
It. It was just their
you
floor
did?
Design.
And we need a wee hole in the wall for bow darts, Kieran.
Johnny and I were talking not that long ago about like, we had speakers, like bigger than that one, right?
Oh,
they were shit. No, they were shit. We spent loads of money on them, and they were absolutely shit. And we just spent our lives carrying them around Belfast. It was fucking depressing. And in McCracken's, they went up on these, like, and I do mean this, unsafe tiny hooks above human heads. Like, as humans.
And that's when he invented the Bluetooth speaker. He was like, we need something wireless. Alexa!
See, when he left for London, I was fucked. I couldn't lift any of our gear. He did it all. He did everything.
He took
everything.
All the blueprints with him. You're fucked. You're
like, I swear to God. See, when he left, I literally remember sitting down and talking to my dad and going, Johnny did it all. Like, and he was like, going to me, get out and get back to work. Like,
what's he doing? Is he gigging in London?
He does music for theatre, and he does music like for adverts and all now.
Oh, why? Anything we know?
He's done like the Bank of Ireland ads. He's done like stuff
so no.
For... you're a wanker.
Bank of
ESPN.
Ireland.
ESPN.
Pardon?
There's nothing like sports or whatever. He did that.
That's not a memorable quote.
He didn't do the quote. He does the music. Oh, my God.
You know that one? There's nothing like sports.
I love the way you're like, do you have an anger problem? And then the two of you ride me from both sides.
That'll be a different show. Let me ask you this. I'm talking about venues. See concert places like this. Like Dave knows this, I don't know if you do. I performed here before, but before I did stand up here, I sang here with the African Children's Choir. My primary school were invited to perform the African Children's Choir. Do they know it's Christmas? That's true, that's 100% true.
Can I ask, what was it about your primary school that they were like, these guys?
We were just all like, fucking unreal, like in the choir scene. Like, we'd have been the bad boys, definitely, of the choir scene, but me and my crew came in here and slayed it. Yeah, we sang Do They Know It's Christmas.
Were they raising money for yous, or were yous...
But, I've played in here, but, like, I'm talking about concerts you've been to, maybe in here. So a lot of people went to their first concert here, or the Ulster Hall, or somewhere like that. So, like, early Belfast concert memories.
Well, he actually was the first guy to perform in this venue.
I started the Laganside redevelopment project. Without me, no Bluefish.
City Hall. There you go.
No Nulla with a Hula without me, all right?
Kieran's the sort of guy in a supermarket sees a suggestions box and goes, fetch my quill. Like, you 100%. They need to know this.
Our school legit.
Chloe, fetch more parchment.
In third year geography, our school legitimately did a trip. I went to school on the Ravenhill Road, right? So this isn't even far. Up the Aquinas Massive, right? And anyway, and it's a diocesan grammar, darling. Anyway, they brought us on. This was the worst school trip I ever went on. They brought us to the Laganside redevelopment on a bus. We drove from the Ravenhill up the embankment, and round the Lagan, and then down the Ormo, round here before it was all built. Back to school, and they were like, it's gonna be class. Yeah. That was it.
I get 100% see you going up to the foreman on that school trip and go, walk with me. And just showing him blueprints.
The only guy with a hard hat in my fizz.
These drains are too wide. You'll get rid of a lot of water, but no one's shoes will get stuck. Like, you know what I mean?
I think one of my first Belfast concert memories was, and one of the best, because you like to think of yourself as a music connoisseur. I do too. One of the best early concerts I went to, Shane Ward, when it was the Odyssey.
Fuck off in the Odyssey?
Huh?
Was that the one where,
hey,
like...
By the way, you say, was that the one that, I'm going to guess he only played it once.
Nice. No, but hold on. Was anybody else at that Shane Ward concert? Give us a shout.
Yes.
Is this just a dream of mine? Or was he singing Breathless, and then next thing you know, he's just flying across the arena?
Yeah. And there wasn't enough people to constitute doing that, but he did it. And also, there was a bit where he did. There was a bit.
Was he on wires?
What? He was, no.
No, he's on Kev.
No, Kieran. No, he's magic.
Was it obvious I'm on a Garth Brooks rope, or was it like...
Let me guess, one night in McCracken's, you fucking levitated through the...
I don't want to be a dick, Shane. I invented magic, right?
So it wasn't for you, David Copperfield, just at the Dole office, flat out.
No dynamo, you know what I mean?
So at the Shane Ward concert, I don't know if you remember this bit, but I was there. Who were you with?
I
was there on a date.
I was
there
just with my dad.
But you'd have been like 16, 17?
Yeah. But hold on, no. My dad was like, he goes, mate, I really like, his voice is unbelievable. And people, I mean, it's true, he won X Factor. Like, his voice, unbelievable.
Yeah.
My dad was like, I just think it would be dodgy if I, as like a 50-year-old guy, went by himself. Right. And I said, I'll go with you, brother. And it was equally as dodgy. I looked like I'd been stolen.
But during that concert, I don't know if you remember this bit, but I remember being like, this is unreal, and I was there on a date. And then Shane Ward goes, it's time for the Prince medley. And I watched him do about 6 Prince songs in like a mega mix format in a purple suit with a purple fedora. And I remember...
No, you fully dreamt that. That's completely made up.
He maybe didn't put the outfit on, but he did the Prince medley. And I remember trying not to cry and being like, oh my God, he would have loved this. Now, I should point out, Prince wasn't dead at this point. But I still thought, if he dies, he'll love this, right? And I remember turning to the girl I was with and going, this is like the ultimate. Like, you couldn't get a con. Shane Ward doing Purple Rain, oh my God. And then I YouTubed it recently, and there's footage of him doing it at a concert, and it is without doubt the shittest thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
But it meant something, you and the girl, you still together?
I mean, no, but... My dad once, he thought this was a nice move. My dad, for not like doing too badly in my GCSEs, and like that shows you my level of IQ, he's like, you didn't get all U's here. He bought me 2 tickets to see Justin Timberlake in the Odyssey when I was like 16 and went, bring a girl. The pressure, I had to get a landline phone number and ring a girl and cordially invite her to go and see Justin Timberlake, and her dad answered, and I said, is Justin there? And then hung up. And then hung up and had to re-rig. That was the worst moment of my life.
And that's the one you end up going with my dad, was it?
Yeah. Yeah, you're... But yeah, like, what, like, concerts would you have gone to, do you remember, back in the day?
I mean, I went to Shane Ward, went to Steps twice. I like that, you know, just funky pop makes it a good time. I like that, Beyonce. I saw James Blunt in here, cried at that. It was lovely. yeah, I just like pop music, you know what I mean?
You getting emotional? I should have patented Bluetooth.
I came here not that long ago to see David Gray, right? And I was sitting up there somewhere, and that's not even important, but anyway, I love Belfast, I love being from here. But people fucking embarrassed me that night. Like,
in front of David?
In front of David. And David David will remember me from the time I stood beside him briefly, like I sit down Patrick Abbey. Chloe's going to say something, he's like your fucking hero. And I went, David, right? I came here and he came out and he played the first song. It was fucking amazing because he's fucking brilliant. He comes out, just comes out singing. I'm going to say this and you're going to think this is bollocks, but it's fucking brilliant. He comes out clapping on his own and just sings with no music.
That sounds shit.
I know, but it's fucking awesome, right? He came out and he did it, and then the band fucking kicks in and all. It was amazing, right? And he goes, listen, guys, I have a new album out. I'm going to play about 6 or 7 songs off a new album. And then it's jukebox time, you know, he's fucking shout for whatever you want, right? And he played the first song after that, and somebody goes, Babylon. And I'm like, for fuck's sake, right? And then he plays the next song, and somebody goes, Babylon. And then somebody else goes, this year's love, please forgive me. And I go, will you just fuck up?
Yeah.
And he goes, listen, the new songs kind of keep this fun for me and the band, and then honestly, we'll really play whatever you want. Does the next song. Seriously, Babylon, right? And then when he plays Babylon, I swear to God, somebody goes, here, Babylon. It's like, it was fucking rare. Was
me and my dad went to see Eric Clapton, right, in the Odyssey once.
That's a good gig. That's a good gig.
I know, it was good, right? During it, he's doing all new songs. Like you said, it's all new songs. And people are starting to shout out requests.
Did you cream?
But he hasn't said. Nish, he's like, oh, well, just we're doing some new stuff. And this guy, the most like from here thing I've ever heard, Eric Clapton goes, I'm doing a few new songs. Guy goes, Eric, cocaine, and then give us a song. And I swear to God, the place fucking erupted and Clapton never got them back. Never got them back.
Have you ever seen anybody lose it at a concert? Like an act just fucking lose
yes.
it? Who'd you see?
Ryan Adams.
Brian or Ryan?
Brian.
Brian. Why did Brian lose it?
No, Brian.
People just kept going, Babylon. And it was you.
Well, actually, Ryan Adams famously did lose it when somebody asked him to play Summer 69 one time. Right. If it was me, I would have just played it, but then I invented music. But then we went to see one of the bands that Ryan Adams was in. We went to see them in the Mandela Hall, the old Mandela Hall. And when Madiba came to me and asked me, no, I'm only joking. In the old Mandela Hall, and he took a guitar off after about 4 songs and like fucked it at somebody. He fucking lost it, right? And this was great because it was also quite Belfast. The sound engineer from Queens comes on, again, pre-smoking band, has the fag in his mouth, I was only about 18. He comes on, walks over to like a monitor speaker and like goes like this. And just goes, right? Walks back over, and then he comes out again, does about another three songs, and then he just goes, do you know what, I'm out. And he just left. He did seven songs. Nobody got their coin. Well, I didn't get my coin back. But you asked how anybody lost it. He lost it.
Dave, you and your dad go to why were you and your dad always going to stuff?
Because we just vibe. Me and him, we just two guys. Like, we went Simply Red together.
Yeah, me and my dad went that too together.
But were you there at the time Mick Hucknall lost it?
No.
Some guy, there was a fella in the front row, thought it'd be great banter to fire an orange afro wig at him. And he just...
That is funny.
And he just stopped. He went, do you think that's fucking funny? And the guy in front row goes, aye, and he goes, why fucking don't? He stormed off, and everyone's like, banter.
Why did Mick go fully shankle?
Do you think that's funny, mate? He's just settling in, he's like, you fucking... But yeah, no way he's known as being a real fucking angry man.
Right.
I thought, we're not getting our money back.
I just love you and your dad going to different forms of live entertainment.
We, like, see, looking back, every memory I have of a concert, for some reason, is me and my dad.
Right.
Like, we went to see, like, All-American Wrestling, right? Just a couple of lads.
Like WWE?
We thought it was WWE. Like, they had all the ticket. It was a proper old school printed ticket, and it said All American Wrestling, and it had like The Undertaker and Stone Cold Steve Austin and Kane and stuff on it. And my dad goes, got you these tickets? And I was like, oh, cheers, Dad. And he goes, they were a bargain, they're only £1 each. And I went, oh, fucking right, you know, for £8. So we got down, it was in the Ulster Hall, right? We got down and...
What age had you been, roughly?
I must have been about 10, right? So we got down to Ulster Hall, and I remember being... Because at that stage still, I was kind of cute, so I was still worried. But you know what I mean? Like, when you're that age, you think there's just guys just waiting to stroke you. They're like, grab you, you know? So I was a bit wary, right? I was like, fuck, right?
I think people at 10 looked at you and thought you might be one of those men that was...
But, you know, you always would hold your daddy's hand, though. And then my daddy got taken away. He always told me I had to. And it was weird that his hand was always in his pocket, but I could see both of them. I don't know. Weird guy. But. Very soft skin. But. but we were going in, and he got scouted, right? He got scouted by one of the bouncers. So one of the guys at the door were like, to him, and he left me, and I was there, and he went, and he was chatting to this fella, and he came back to me, and he was like, listen, son, the guy running this has offered me our money back if I join the Royal Rumble later in the night, if that's...
And he goes, 60
no.
quid.
So yeah, for 60 quid, he's like, for 60 quid, Royal Rumble. But then he was like, nah, I'm not going to do that. So the guy was like, listen, I'll move you and your wee special son to the front. And he's like,
this wee sexy bastard.
He goes, I'll move you to the front row then if you do security. Because I think it was just this guy and his mate. I think it was Kieran and Gianni. We're like, listen, we're running this wrestling gig. So then it started, right? And you heard Kane's music come on. It all went, lights went red. And it was, no offense, some fella your build with an afro wig on and a red suit. And I was like, that's not Kane.
Was it Mick Hucknall?
But it was just all these just fellas just dressed as not a real wrestler amongst them. And then my dad just had to be security for it. So we got to go. It was nice. They said to me afterwards, like, do you want to meet the wrestlers? And I was like, nah, I'm sweet. I'll just go home with my dad. But it was a nice time.
Can I ask a question? Where was this, did you say?
The Ulster Hall.
That's mad.
Yeah.
And they were dressed as famous wrestlers.
Yes.
Do you know what's mad about that? That's like, they're doing that. That's like, that's their business. Every kid that goes that will know that's not real and be disappointed. That's fucking madness. Like,
yeah.
It's mad.
But the thing about it was, the guy that was doing The Undertaker couldn't do The Undertaker eyes. He just kept crossing his eyes, which was hilarious. So this dude was just like walking around.
Because The Undertaker rolls him up, so his eyes were all white.
But this guy was just walking the kids in the front row going, oh. And I was like, fuck.
I'm going to stick on a United shirt after this and do Roy Keane autographs outside if anybody wants them.
Who do you think you could pass yourself off as a famous person? Who do you think, if there was like a knockoff show, who do you think you could do?
Ross Kemp. Leave it. It's family. Done. Done.
What about you?
Hmm?
What about you?
I could host an episode of the Ellen DeGeneres Show and nobody would tweet anything. Would just be like, nobody. I wouldn't get a tweet about it. Nobody would be like, "The fuck is up with this?" It would just be a normal episode. From a distance, I could also be the girl in Stranger Things, if I shave my head. Dave,
Well, Pavarotti, of course. Like, I mean, I look just... I have his exact face, like, don't I? Or it's his niche, but, you know, Razor Ruddock used to play for Liverpool. Yeah. I just look... I look like him now, but he's like 70, you know?
Yeah. What about Non from Superman 2?
Yeah, I'll take that.
That film was huge in my house, to be fair.
Yeah, I'll take that.
I don't know, like, I have a face, people are like, I look like people, so I reckon there's a load of different...
I mean, again, I don't know if we should say this, but since it's a podcast, we're kind of like, well, imagine they're not there, it's just a bit of banter, it'd be edited out. You look like that person that was like, are you getting blocked tonight? Yeah!
Who's that?
You're saying, if I put two earrings on?
Put two earrings on, comb my hair down, bingo.
I feel so lost right now, I don't know what he's on about.
You're a bad boy.
Sorry?
You're a bad boy.
Do you know what he's on about?
No.
Oh,
never
mind. Yes.
Dan, big screen, please.
No, fuck that.
I don't know, I think I could do Ellen DeGeneres. There's quite a few people like
Cantona?
No.
With a collar on?
Can you see?
What? Could you... I know what I say when I look at my mirror, dude.
You 1,000% could do Sinead O'Connor. I'd like to see that. Just a wee single tear going down your face.
Please make that happen. That'd be fucking brilliant.
Intensely singing and into the lens.
Yeah.
I could do that. I know. What about Grant's brother? What's his name?
Phil.
Steve McFadden?
Yeah.
If I do like a couple of press-ups before, go red.
The people up at the top seats, if they didn't know what they were coming to and it looked like Ellen DeGeneres hosting a Q&A with Phil Mitchell and Minty from EastEnders, people believe it.
Good shout.
Also, you could be the go compare guy from a distance if he lost the gig. Go compare guy.
Go compare.
Okay. Oh, go compare. I thought you said the golden bear guy. I'm like, the golden bear guy.
Yeah, he's a ball bag guy. See them adverts. See the adverts where he plays the go compare guy and himself and saying, oh, it fucking
cracks you up.
Stresses me out. Do you know how long it took them to shoot that? Ages. And it's balls.
Who do you know on the go compare set?
No, I just know it took ages because they have to do everything twice.
Right.
Balls.
This guy invented cinema.
Have you ever been in an ad?
In an ad? No, I've turned a couple down.
What did you turn down?
An alcohol company. I don't drink.
Is it a local alcohol company?
Fuck off, yes. But anyway,
is it their thing?
I don't know. Because I don't know any.
Was it hard?
Recently, another company has fucking started calling a beer No Blasters. I'm about to fucking slide tackle in that place with my fucking balls out. Oh, they don't know what's coming, but it's coming.
Just standing out the front.
I know, yeah. Eric Cantona's coming to kick your balls in, yeah.
Oh, wow. Now, what else have you turned down?
I think that was it.
Dad, I told you about my Harry Corey ad experience.
Yes.
I don't know about this now.
So, you said you were a cute kid.
Yeah.
Right? I 1,000%, that was real sexy.
But
guy.
You had these, like, weird eyes and ears and those teeth. You looked like a freak. You looked like maybe your parents were siblings. Like, you... Like, you're getting sexier. Like, I think by the time you're 40, fuck, I'd probably bend you over. But I think, like, see, when I was like a wee fucking fat, brown-haired, sexy wee bastard. But then I just, you know.
No, you don't have hair.
No.
I looked like the wee boy out of King of the Hill when I was a child.
So I'm like, I don't know, 5 or something. My mom says, you've been asked to go down and audition for a Harry Corey ad because we knew someone through the family who was casting it. So they were like, do you want to go and do it? And you knew the ads at the time. We need help. We need Harry. They were the ads, right? There'd be a family in the house. So I go down to a place in the gasworks there and there's hundreds of kids and I'm looking them up and down. I was like, okay, like they're probably all like actors. I'd never done anything like that before. And I go in, there's a director, two directors, two guys, and the guy goes, right, here's the line. He goes, all you need to do is look in the camera and you say, I'm going to say, we need help. And you say, we need Harry. Have you got that? And I was like, yeah. He said, we need help. And I was like, we need Harry. I was so good, right? The guy had a root. I was so good. And they kept re-auditioning me and bringing me back, and then they would lose some kids, they'd come back. Eventually, it was like me and two other kids, I was there all day. I didn't have any intentions to ever act. And eventually, they were like, you, one more time, I did it, killed it. They sent the last other boy home. Guy goes, I've been there for like 4 hours. Guy goes, congratulations, we're going to give you the part. We'll speak to your mummy about all the contract and all that sort of thing. He goes, now, I just have to ask you, do you definitely want to do this, don't you? And I was like, no. I just flat was like, no, I don't want to. And he laughed, and I was like, I don't want to do this. And the guy's like, why the fuck are you still here? I was like, I don't know. And they had to just get other boys back.
You were standing there, you're like, I'm trying to leave, but there's a 1 foot wall and we drain, and I just can't.
I rang you once, and you went, oh, you were wearing like a singlet, and you were like lifting Atlas stones for some sort of ad, which, by the way, can I just point out how weird is this? I never saw.
So what
Sorry.
Was this?
Like, singlet?
Yeah, well.
Yeah, you were playing like a strong man or something.
No, what? There's a couple of, I've been a strong man in an ad for lagging tiles where I had to break like a tile, and believe it or not, couldn't do it. But then I was also involved, like, listen, you're mistaking two things. So I was a strong man in one ad. I was wearing shorts and a t-shirt there. Sexy. In another ad, this new company had set up, and they had made this pretty bespoke product that would make camel toe hard to see. So, like,
so what?
Yeah, this is true, right? So this.
But hold on.
Yeah.
Why did they ask you to be in it?
Because they needed a guy that wouldn't mind running around with effectively a camel toe. So I had to like run around.
You're saying there was a company that set up, and their business strategy was like, we're going to sell men.
No,
a product.
No. It was for women. But
you're such a good actor.
I had to do it. No. But this is what's ridiculous. I've never seen the finished ad. Yeah. All I know is I spent.
So you filmed something?
Oh, yeah. I just walked there. It might just have been for some banter, like, I think, now looking back on it. But I just walked around Botanic with effectively a minge and my fat out for an afternoon. And I thought I got away with it, but there's a guy who like promotes gigs, and for some reason he had like this photo of me, and I don't know. And every time I do the gig, he's like, "Remember this?" I'm like, "Yes, I fucking do. Just stop showing me." And if I will get that photo, and I'll send it to
you. Did you get paid for this?
I don't think so. I just think I, you know.
It was a passion project.
But you know, when you start out, you're like, would you just like to get out of the house for a few hours? Like, yeah, sweet. That's...
Dave always does one project for them and one for himself then after. That's mad. That's like, that very much sounds like someone who maybe just wanted to see your cock and balls. Just
yeah, and I mean, it was like, they were very much like, you know, you might be uncomfortable doing this. And I was like, yeah. And then they showed me the leotard, and I was like, yeah, I was like, I don't want to do it. And they're like, well, there's people waiting to see this.
I don't understand, though, how putting you in the leotard would convince a woman that will hide my unsightly camel hoof.
But there was, right, I was just a star of it. I didn't come up with the idea, right? But the you can buy... Like,
I'm sorry, just clarify, this was for harp?
But then what you had to do, you had to pop the wee thing in, and it's like, look, there goes the camel toe. Boom.
Yeah.
Well, it must be good at hiding a camel toe if it can hide a dick.
No, they were all good with Dave.
That's mental.
Listen, we all have our party tricks, Kieran. We all.
Speaking of work and jobs, right, let me ask you this. Did you ever do work experience?
Yes.
I guarantee you asked for something like a real old-timey type job.
I didn't.
Like, whoever you did it with, you had to call them skipper, and it wasn't on the boat.
Do you know what I legit asked for? I didn't get it. I asked. This is you've opened the can of worms, right? I asked, could I go to a newspaper?
Right.
Right. I actually wanted to go to the Irish News, because you might not know this about me, Shane, but from the ages of 6 to 18, I was a member of the press gang of the Irish News. Now, that's a very.
So you're saying you were in a gang, like a lot of people from your world as a kid.
What?
A lot of people from here would have been in gangs as a kid, like have a past or not proto. Yeah. Your gang was called the...
The press gang. Now, so people might have been in gangs where they were like sniffing like Africa or fucking bricks at the authorities. I was in one where I was like scribbling down scoops. Do you know what I mean? I was a wee nerd, right?
Yeah.
Do you know who the head of the press gang was? Eddie Tor, as in editor.
I'm not much of a stupid
this
guy.
True.
I was like, I don't know.
This is true. The Irish News legit. I think they still do it. They put my age on the newspaper every birthday of mine until I was 18. Anyway.
I have a feeling Kieran might have been the only guy in the press.
I asked, could I go there? And my school led me to believe that I was going there. And then I came into the school and they were like, you're going to a primary school. And I went, right. What about the newspaper? They went, you're going to a primary school. Just pretend you want to be a teacher. And I was like, well, I fucking don't. Do you know what they did? They put me with an educational theatre company. Now, this was a wee theatre company. They were sending a wee play. Have I told you about this before? They were sending me round the province with a wee tour of a play that was about fire safety for kids. And basically all
What age were you?
16? 17.
Right.
All I did for a week was like hump gear in and out of fucking schools, right? And in and out of like a wee theatre. But the play was like, they had this quite flamboyant guy, and he was playing the part of fire, right? So it was very much a play that was like, don't burn yourselves, right? It was a bit...
I could just see him.
It was a bit mad, right? And do you know what's mental? I've gone on to work with two actors that were in this. Anyway, they were doing their thing. I was just in the background. Now, two things happened that were sort of interesting. One was one day, the sound... So on yeah, this all happened on one day, actually. The what's happened to Dave?
I think he's just settling in.
Just settling in.
I'm sorry.
I actually went on to work with two of these actors.
No, fuck off. No, this is funny. I think so. Sit there. They did this thing where we're doing the show and there's a lot of magic tricks in the show, right?
And you invented that.
I taught them how to do magic, right? I invented God. And anyway, so some of the tricks were like, fire would burst, he would break a balloon out of nowhere.
Sorry, hold on, fire would what?
No, fire would just burst, right? No, he would whip out like a balloon,
he
would magically burst the balloon with a hidden blade and pull out a load of flowers, and then the flowers would turn into something that was all a bit weird, right?
What the fuck's that got to do with fire?
Because he was like, it was all, ooh, right, anyway. You never know what fire's going to do next, Dave. It could be a ball. It could be your dead family, right? You don't know. You can't trust fire, right?
The primary school.
I know, right? Yeah, it was very weird. It was so weird, right? And one of the days, the guy came in. He was a wee bit, I think he was a wee bit hungover. And he came in, and when he went to burst that balloon, it didn't burst. And then he went to really jam this blade into the balloon. He kind of cut his hand a bit. And it was all kids are literally going, fire! And it was absolutely fucking mad. And the sound engineer goes to me, run backstage, tell the director fucking this, whatever this information was. And I went back there, and oh, mate, she bollocked me. Like, she was like, what are you doing back here? Get my fucking way! And I was just like, I was 17, but and I was a wee prince. But I definitely was just like, I'm not dealing with you today, I'm not. I just left. I just fucking walked out.
Right.
And later, I get a phone call later on. I'm literally sitting. Do you know when you walk out, but you realize you're in Armagh and having the way home?
Yeah.
And I remember I marched to a fucking an Esso garage and jammed all my feelings down inside me with a bag of jelly babies. Just like...
Down the M2.
I was literally fisting a Swiss roll into myself, right? Just like,
And what does that say about fire?
when they finally called up to me and they coaxed me back onto the bus with a promise that we were going to the Mayor of Armagh's house that day, and there would be free curry, and I went. It's a true story, because one of the actors was the Lord Mayor's son.
They own, like any other kid, it would be Sweeties or something like that. Yeah. A visit to the Lord Mayor's house.
Oh, here was class.
You're the sort of guy, if the police were on your street, you'd ask them for a wee bit of their tape. 100%. Dave, where did you do your work experience?
I did work experience at the BBC.
Oh, did
so
you?
I went in and just sat with Jackie Fullerton for a day. That was good crack. And then I got sent out with a...
You were under Jackie's wing?
Yep, I was under Jackie for a
what
day.
What was that like?
Class. A lot of fun. And then we went out for a day. I went out with a guy who he was really fucked off the whole day, and he had to do a whole presentation about the poinsettia, the Christmas plant. And that was my work experience. So I sat with him, and he just, the amount of times he'd go, this is the punth, fuck's sake, and just over and over. And he's like, mate, don't tell your teachers I'm fucking swearing, just have a fucking this and that. And it was a lot of fun. So anytime I see, I can't remember his name, but every time I see him, I'm like, Ponsetti, mate.
I did mine at vets.
Let me ask, why?
Well, I wanted to be a pilot. But they couldn't do that. So they said, do you want to go to the vets? And I said, yeah. But then on my first day in the vets, I said, I don't like any animals, and I get freaked out and all that, and I don't like blood or anything like that. So I just sat in like the owner of the vet's office space and just sat.
So what in the beginning, when Kieran invented the world, what did you remember the first jobs you wanted? Like, do you remember like what you wanted to be when you grew up?
Go ahead.
Legitimately, my ma talks about this sometimes. I said one time, this is true, and I could only have been about 5 or 6. I said that, so we went to the dentist, right? And I realized, I saw the bill that my ma had to pay at the dentist, and I was like, oh, what? Right? And I went, Mummy, do you know what I want to be? She goes, what? And I went, I want to be, this is how young I was, I didn't know the word archaeologist. I went, I want to be an Indiana Jones in the summer and the dentist in the winter. So I'll cream it going around the world, fucking whipping people, cha-cha, fucking like, that's not even noise it makes, is it? That's a weird whip. Something wrong with it, the batteries must be running low. Cha-cha, you know what I mean?
You do look like the sort of guy, if you had a whip, it would be battery powered. I can't be fucked.
It's just like, just press a wee button, it takes me on, puts me on the escalator.
With a battery. Kieran doing S&M but does not move at any point. It's all simulator. Just sitting, VR headset. Up on a swing.
And then, I want to be a dentist because of the coins.
You look like a guy who'd be in an S&M club but just chilling.
Yeah, it's nothing to me.
No.
I love that smell. Yeah.
Just reading the Irish news. Yeah, work experience. Work experience is weird. People went and did cool things, but yeah, I just sat in an office at a vet's and heard animals being...
Was it a big vet? Like, was it a vet that did like horses and all, or was it like... I mean, I suppose were they a big animal vet, is what I mean?
Yeah, they mainly did. They were pretty big on animals, yeah.
Yeah. No, but
you could say they specialised in it. I want to ask you about this. You nearly pulled out of the show tonight because of an injury.
Yes.
Right? He phoned me and said he's got an injury and he might not be able to do the show. So I'm thinking, you know, you've hurt your leg badly. Yes. Or your back or something like that.
I was biting my nails, right? And a few days ago, it got a wee bit sore. And then, like, yesterday, it got a wee bit, like, red and swollen. And then I started losing the feeling in my arm. And I thought, maybe I've just got sepsis. I'm going to die. But I went to the chemist and they were like, you're going to need an antibiotic for that. And I was like, but I need it today. And they're like, you can't get it. And I was like, well, might I die? And they were like, well, potentially of many things, but I don't think sepsis will get you now.
10 out of 10, if you had to cancel Ulster Hall tomorrow night and they were like, oh, is it like a sign of respect? And they're like, he died? What happened? He was biting his nails and it's killed him.
Did you ever do that though? Did you ever bite it and it does that thing where
yes, literally,
just,
that's
fucking
what...
might as well just go up your whole shoulder?
I don't bite my nails because I'm not an angsty teenager.
I bite them because I don't like nail clippers. I think they're fucking...
I never think about getting my nails clipped and be like, oh, yes.
Give me your hand.
Mine are quite long.
Do you do that with your teeth?
Yeah. I have straight teeth.
Fuck me. Well, there's a new job for you. You should just go into being a fucking nail technician. They are the straightest, most beautiful natural nails I've ever seen.
They're a wee bit long at the minute because I've been playing.
Can I have a bite?
A bite?
A bite?
No, don't.
Yeah, no. Don't be a dick. Let him bite.
Don't be a dick. No.
Guys, would you just, like, do things in the name of comedy? Would you like to see Dave bite Kieran's nails just a wee bit? Just a wee bit. Don't be a dick. Don't be a dick, Kieran. Don't be sly.
Mate, just put your finger in there. Lovely.
Yes. Suck his dick off.
That's right. Do you ever get a snatter that's like that as well? You know, where you put, like, it's crispy. I get this when I've been around air conditioning for a while, where it's crispy on this end. You think, oh, I'll just fucking drag out of myself and throw it into my tea or whatever, right? But it's like, I'll throw it into my fucking mugshot, right? And I, do you know what I've been doing recently? Fucking them out the window of the car and hoping a seagull gets it. I swear to God.
How big are they?
Oh, mate, sometimes you see these ones. Do you ever get the ones and it wraps around your nose like a fucking bed sheet? And you pull it out, and then at the end of it, that's the bit where it looks like a fucking bungee cord. And it's wet as... Oh, it's fucking
well, after rank. He's the original magician. So.
Genuinely, see, when I was a kid, I used to wipe my snatters under the arm of the sofa. And you know what's mental? I didn't meet Chloe until I was, 28 or something, 29.
Due to shared interest?
She used to do that when she was a kid as well. I've just outed that, by the way. She didn't know I was going to say it tonight.
That's stinking.
Surprise.
You're a wee dirty guy.
I used to be more dirty. My snatters are stinking still, but I do give them to seagulls. I'm lowering my carbon footprint, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
What's the dirtiest thing you do?
Oh, someone's gonna poke over there. The dirtiest thing, I mean, somebody hates it. I haven't even said it yet. The snatters is probably right up there.
I could see you storing meat in weird places on yourself.
Just like, again, I was saying last night at a gig, I can hide a Sky remote in my crevice. The crevice is what is the wee bit under my belly.
Yeah.
Where like all manner of things live, right? It's mental. Like it's actually mental in there. It's not even like human skin anymore. I said this to you earlier. My bollocks have basically been underwater since I was 17.
Oh, let me get my snorkel. Oh.
It's madness.
And
I know what the dirtiest thing is I do.
Is that your wife? No, don't tell him.
No, I know what this is rotten. This is, and I'll be, can I say this? It's not even that bad. It's not as bad as the snatters, but it is. It's not as gippy as the snatters, but it is the worst thing I do.
Just say it.
I sometimes say if I've maybe had, shall we say, a long day, right? And you know your sweat lines.
Sure, pretend I do.
The micro crevices on either side of your bag, right? In there, see if you get a good scratch in there. Dave knows what I'm talking about. You get a wee scratch. You get a wee scratch in there. Now, what you scratch and what comes off on your hand wouldn't be fit for a science lab to look at, right?
But yet Salt Bae over here.
And yet, I know that's what I was about to say. I don't eat it, but occasionally I'll do it. Forget I've done it, and then I go to scratch my nose, and I huff it.
Oh, you're stinking.
And, you know, and I swear to God, it smells like an old goalie glove. I don't even know what's happened.
I would find it so therapeutic to scrub you from head to toe. I would love to treat you like, who's the guy used to dig all the stuff up? Timmy Mallett?
Yeah.
Time Team? I would love to...
No, not Timmy Mallett, no.
Timmy Mallett would be a good fucking archaeologist.
I know. Mallett's Mallett, just fucking...
Oh, who's the guy that digs everything up? Robin?
Robinson.
Peter
Tony
Robinson.
Tony Robinson.
I would love to treat you like an archaeological dig and just like get you spread out the big slab and just like really scrub you head to toe and put you in a wee nighty.
You want to do a post-mortem? You know, I reckon people exist that would pay good money to watch that. Maybe one of them, for sure.
What's the stinkingest thing you do?
I don't really do anything personally stinking, but I have done things accidentally stinking. Like my kids, I've eaten their shit by accident before.
Oh.
Yeah, one of my kids, whenever she was a wee baby, did a shit and a bit of it fell out on the floor. I thought it was a blueberry, went, oh, I'll have that. Wasn't a blueberry, it was full of shit. That was pretty disgusting.
A poo berry, if you will.
Yeah. That was horrendous.
Now, would you consider, right, stand-up's going well, right? Everyone's doing, as well as doing like a podcast here, everyone's doing big shows. Dave's in the Ulster Hall tomorrow night. And Dave, you said there's some tickets still available?
I want to say some. There's a couple of hundred. And
yeah,
they're there. And you know, listen, it's going to be a good time. But.
And you say if you shifted even the ground, you'd be willing. He said to me, I'll do anything. So like, as in, if we help him sell more, he would be willing to do anything.
No, I said if it were to sell out, I would do. If you give me a dare, I'd do it.
Right. if you did.
I'd suck his dick if it doesn't sell any more tickets.
I don't want that.
You'd drown.
Yeah, and that would show they've done a good job.
Sorry. I was going to say something similar. The dare would be what's in Kieran's crevice. And you know, like an I'm a Celebrity, where they do that trial where they put their hat.
It'd be like through the keyhole, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Dave's just walking around the crevice going, who would own a place like this?
Let's go through the a-hole, absolutely.
Kieran's crevice has a receptionist. As soon as you walk in. Do you know what's gross? That's bound to not be the grossest thing you do, but it's the grossest thing you're willing to tell us about. If you're willing to tell us about that, what the fuck do you do really in private?
No, that is the grossest thing I do, is I'll huff the sweat line every now and again.
Huff the sweat
you
line?
You have to huff it. You can't just lightly smell it.
Is that an accident, like accidentally, or do you properly, like...
I've done it accidentally, but then occasionally I have absolutely done it on purpose.
Like a wee jockey loaf?
Just a check. Yeah, just to check it.
See, in a minute, right, when we did Limelight, we took audience questions. There's simply too many people here. But the guy I was talking to earlier when I first came out in the white hat, mate, you're the only person that's going to ask a question, so I have a few minutes to think about it. And I am putting you on the spot right now again. Take your time to think about it, but make it good, mate. And don't be anybody else telling him, like a guy beside him. Just you come up with something yourself, mate. And bear in mind, you're the only one in front of 2,000 people that's going to be asking a question. So just, I'm giving you a few minutes to think about it. I see all gross things and all. I don't like it.
You must do something, though.
No, I don't
you
like
do.
It.
You do. Oh, you wee boy, you do. I see that. You do something. Something's stinking.
You eat fish with your fingers all the time. That's pretty gross.
I do that. Yeah. I do the meat thing, obviously. You know, the test of meat with my tongue, the temperature of meat with my tongue. Everyone knows about that.
I fucking didn't, but...
Do you guys know about him?
Most people...
Meat?
Yeah, right, not I don't think... So,
tell the story, please.
Well, you were told it
behind
my back.
Well, a mutual friend we had went, is she in a mental bastard? And I went, well, in what context? He goes, we were at his house for a barbecue, right? And I went out to get some drinks and he was doing the barbecue because it was his house, he wanted to whatever. I looked out the window and I saw Shane with two forks lifting a piece of essentially raw chicken off the barbecue and just going...
What was that for people at the back?
And just licking it with his tongue, just... And then
is
he
this
went
meat
out.
That other people are going to eat?
Yeah.
That's
No. Listen, you've changed it to try and save grace. But then you said, oh, I'm just checking that it's cooked. Salmonella boy just...
Look
at it. If it's white, it's cooked.
I will never let you cook for me.
By the way, you can't say that nowadays, actually. it needs to be piping in the middle.
No, so, it needs to be white.
Yeah, Dave's right here, look.
Well, so, I mean, when it comes to food, I'm not going to argue with you guys.
You know that's actually sexual assault nowadays, by the way.
So, I needed to know it was cooked in the middle. Now, hear me out on this because it's not weird.
It is.
What I do is, if I'm cooking up a spread for people, I'll go to my bit if they all look like they're cooking evenly. And I'll get a knife, cut into the chicken a bit in the middle. And then, like, you know, you asked if I do anything weird and dirty. And I said, no. Now I'm saying this. Wee bit gross. I cut down the middle of the chicken, take it off the barbecue. And then I, like, pull it open so you get, like, a... I was going to say slit. That's stinking. I get, like, a wee crevice opening up. And then all I do is just, a wee... bullfrog. I put my tongue in the middle of it, and if it burns my tongue, it's good to go. And if it's cold, but it's not weird. I only check the bits I eat. I wouldn't lick your meat. I only lick my own meat.
That's crazy, look.
So I don't think that's gross because I'm the only one.
Do you remember there used to be an advert here that was like a public health warning advert, and it was a guy. With
just
place.
On the barbecue.
This was a barbecue advert. Do you remember this? And it was a guy, and they blurred his face out like he was a fucking serial killer. And he's literally just going, "Oh, I was making sausages for my mates, and two of them got poisoned." Do you remember this? Am I the only one who fucking seen this?
Yeah.
Oh, it was nuts. Oh, mate. No, yeah, that's fucking.
Did
that's,
you and the
that's nuts.
You and the cool guys in the press gang do a scoop about it? Mate, sorry, what's your name, big guy? Jamie? Jamie, hit us with a question, mate. Okay, get beside you.
Dude, hold on. Did you say you haven't got one? Do better, Jimmy. You gave him a warning and everything. There must be something.
Jimmy, do you listen to the podcast right now, mate? You do? Why did I not get Jimmy Nesbitt on? So, that was on the live podcast today. If anyone didn't see, we were talking. Nesbitt came up in conversation. And I said, I've been messaging Nesbitt, but I don't know how far I can get. Now, Diona was like, you don't have Nesbitt's number. I was like, darling, if anyone's anyone here, I've got their number. I've got Nesbitt's number, I've got fucking Malachi Kush's number, Frostbit Boy. I have everybody's number, right? So I text Nesbitt on the podcast. Now, he left me on read last time, because we've tried, it's a wee bit like Cat and Mouse, right? And that's one of his new detective series that's coming out. Cat and Mouse, where Nesbitt is got a full face paint of a mouse, and he's going after a baddie called the Cat.
Eddie Torr's been murdered.
So I messaged Nesbitt again on the podcast. Hey, Jimmy, just checking in, see if we could do the pod. Nesbitt replies, I'll check in ASAP. I'm like in my head going, check in now. Like, you're talking to me now? You know, like crosshatch. We'll see tomorrow. I'm like, see me now. So I don't know where we are with Nesbitt. All I know is my phone is upstairs. In fact, my phone's upstairs. If someone flies up and gets it from the green room, we could leave him a video. Right here, right now. Of maybe we get the phone, yeah, someone's ready to get the phone. We get the phone, we bring the lights up, and we just get everybody to go, Jimmy, do the podcast, please. And I think if 2,000 people are asking him,
can I just think say, he might do it. I think this is a great idea, but also, without me coaching Jimmy, without me doing that, this wouldn't have happened. I've invented this.
I'd love a 10 out of 10. What a surprise for the end of the podcast if you just produce Nesbitt from your crevice. Yes, Aaron Butler, thank you very much. Hey, gentlemen, Aaron Butler. Sexy wee guy. Right, so let's go here. Jimmy Nesbitt. So the last interaction I...
Do you actually have his number?
Yes. Man. Last interaction I had was...
Send us it.
Hi. Hi, Jimmy. Sorry to melt you, but could we arrange the podcast if you're still up for it? Nesbitt says, yes, I'll get back ASAP. I say, cheers, Jimmy, appreciate it. And then 7 hours later, I'm going to send him this. So this is 100% real. We'll not even bring the lights up, right? But what I'll do is I'll pretend I'm just talking to him, right? And I'll be like, hey, Jimmy, it's Shane, just want to ask you something. And then when I say just want to ask you something and turn the phone around, everybody go, do tea with me, please, Jimmy. Right? So I go, Jimmy, just want to ask you something, mate. In fact, a few people want to ask you. Do the podcast, please, Jimmy. In fact, I've said two different things, Kieran. Kieran, copyright this, copy edit this.
Do tea with me, please, Jimmy.
Do tea with me, please, Jimmy. Okay, so here we go. So right at the start, don't join in. And then here, what does everybody say?
Do tea with me, please, Jimmy.
Okay. Hey, Jimmy, how's it going? Cheers for getting back to me earlier. I'd love it if you did the podcast. Don't want to ask you again, but in fact, quite a few people want to ask you again. Do the
do
podcast,
tea with me, please,
Jimmy!
What I love about that, you said it all right, he fucked it up.
Did I fuck it up?
You fucked that, yeah.
Did I fuck it up?
You said, yes. Do the podcast, Jimmy! Everyone else, 2,000 people, I commanded them. Fucking unbelievable.
You would love to individually command them with your battery-powered whip, just sitting here. Guys, fucking hope Nesbitt does a podcast. Thank you for the question. I appreciate that. Guys, thanks so much for coming on the podcast. I really appreciate it, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks.
Dave Elliott and Kieran Bartlett. We Like this started in a Dave, what about our last studio? It was £116 a month to rent. It was above a restaurant. You had to go through a fire.
That was when I stood in the human shit to get to it, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. That genuinely is true.
That was the first.
And started this, could never. I didn't know this many people would listen to it. Never mind, come to see it live. So I appreciate it so much. This is wild. Thanks very much. Appreciate the boys coming on. It would have been a surprise if you brought Nesbitt out. And Kieran, one thing I know about you is you like surprises, don't you?
Fuck up, man.
No, but you love a surprise. Have I picked that up wrong?
Fuck up. Oh, no, mate, no.
Do you like surprises?
It's just, no, it's are you fucking May McFetridge?
hey, what have you heard? Oh, yes, I am. He's behind me. Now, I know you don't like surprises, so I wouldn't put you on the spot. I wouldn't have arranged anything without you knowing that I thought would be a great way to end the Tea With Me live podcast in the Waterfront Hall.
I'm legitimately a wee bit of poo, just... A wee duke is just crawling down a wee bit.
Dave will eat it. Ladies and gentlemen, all the way from Rome, Italy, please welcome to the stage, Gianni! Gianni's here, mate! This is unbelievable. Gianni, Choi, gracias. He doesn't speak English, right? Ladies and gentlemen, I want these guys to do a song. You're being a good sport about this. I know you hate surprises, but we flew Gianni over to do this. Take us back to McCracken's in 2006. Let's do it.
Is this weird, Twanky?
Gianni has a wee something prepared.
I tried to discover a little something to make me sweeter.
That's a song that they wanted to play. Kier, like, you played that back in the day. Gianni told me you wanted to play that. I only want you to perform songs you want to do, unless everybody wanted to hear...
Songs, plural.
Wonderwall.
Wonderwall. Wonderwall.
I mean,
Wonderwall.
I'm not really prepared for it. So
when we do this, get the phone lights up. This is going to be unbelievable, lady. He's gone.
He's away. Home.
He's out.
Gianni, once again, we appreciate you being here. Oh, yes. Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, one more time. Get the phone lights up. It's Kieran and Gianni.
This is a wee bit bigger than McCracken's twink.
It is a wee bit. We can't trap them all, Gianni.
Yeah. I'll try. It doesn't smell like vodka and Red Bull either. No. It's weird.
Aye, fuck it.
Babylon, mate.
Today was gonna be the day, and then we're gonna throw it back to you. By now you should somehow realize what you gotta do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. Backbeat, the word is on the street that the fire in your heart is out. I'm sure you heard it all before, but you never really had a doubt. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. In all the roads you have to walk the winding, in all the lights you lead the way of living, there are many things that I would like to say to you, but I don't know how. You said maybe, you're gonna be the one that saves me, and after all, you're my after all, and after all.
ladies and gentlemen. What about that, Kieran and Johnny? Guys, thank you so much for coming to this podcast. Give it up for everyone you saw tonight. First of all the way from Italy, Gianni! Woo! What about my guest, first of all, Dave Elliott! Woo! Yep, Dave's doing the Ulster Hall tomorrow night. Do go to that, ladies and gentlemen. The Goblin King himself, the man with the beautiful voice, Kieran Bartlett! Guys, thank you so much for coming to this podcast. We really appreciate it. Hope you guys have a great night. Cheers, Sippers. I'm Shane Todd. Safe home.